for the past few years. He's on the board of many notable companies, including SpaceX, Synthetic Genomics, and Tesla Motors. And from what I hear, he's an ardent collector of space artifacts, and he has his own personal museum at DFJ. And he's also into amateur rocketry, and the videos and the pictures that I've seen in the past are just amazing, and hopefully he'll be able to share some more today. And without further ado, please help in welcoming me, Steve Jurvetson.
Thank you very much. Great. All right, is this on? And everyone can hear me? Great. Well, thanks. How many of you were here last year? Just out of curiosity, because I heard there were, oh, good, a number of new hands. How many 2 years ago? Oh, those are the same hands. So we got the regulars and the newbies. This is great. I'll try to perhaps say something of interest to both. As was mentioned, I have a keen interest in space as an investor, as a collector, and I'm not normally a collector. I haven't collected anything in my life until about 5 years ago, and then it just went completely out of control. My children and I have been launching rockets for the last 11 years out in the Black Rock Desert and various other places as amateurs. And it's just wonderful when those interests can infuse an investment thesis. And I started in venture capital, God, it's been 15 years ago. I never imagined that satellites and rockets and cars and robots and drones and everything cool in life would ever be, actually legitimate venture investments. Back then it was all semiconductors, software, and healthcare, basically biotech. And it's a really exciting time right now. I'll try to share some of that enthusiasm with you today, as well as some of the latest developments in companies that we're tracking, and try to generalize a bit, obviously, for the new space phenomenon, whatever that might be in your mind, and why it excites us, and why we think there's a lot of potential still ahead of it in new areas like broadband, data, and obviously colonization of other worlds. So, let me start with SpaceX. It was mentioned that I'm involved there, and it's just an exciting company. Every year that passes, new progress gets made. Obviously, images of their launches are well known, and the rough sense of scale of that fairing is it's kind of hard to tell from a distance, and it's a little faint, but a bus easily fits in there. And that really speaks to the earliest and most common genre of geosynchronous satellites. They are the size of buses. You can think of them as buses. You can think of some of the new generation satellites like Skybox as little mini fridges, and of course the CubeSats and others are like loaves of bread, at least in the 3U format. Very different sense of scale, cost, and methodologies of how you run a business, but I'll get more to that later. SpaceX has been one of the enablers both for us to think now is the time to contemplate businesses in space, and for a couple reasons. One is it's nice to have competition driving prices down, so every business that launches something into orbit could perhaps rely on a lower cost to orbit. That's good, and hopefully more progress will be made. But there's a subtle second point, which is it's just good to know what the price is. To actually have that listed on a website, whatever the number is, really helps entrepreneurs everywhere when they're putting together a business plan. It's kind of funny how if you have a closed industry where you have to be an insider to really know what the negotiated outcome of a price is, it's kind of a bit off-putting for new entrants who don't know anything about launch, nor do they need to, nor should they know what launch is or what it costs. They should be able to look it up and find out, right? So that's kind of nice. There have been some beautiful launches this past year. I love them when they're dusk, whether it's a hobby launch or a big one, because the lighting is just so beautiful. This is a photo I modified. I didn't take it, but I tweaked it to draw out the color. And this was a slide I showed last year. I apologize for those who saw it, but I just want to set the context for those who might not know it. There's been a dramatic shift in the market for commercial launch. In 1980, the United States had 100% market share. That's the blue far left bar. You can notice that in 2010 through 2012, that market share dropped to zero. Now, the reason commercial launch is interesting is it's the only place, well, not the only, it's the place where you have a free market. If you're talking about military launches, clearly pick a government, they're not going to fly on another government's launch vehicle unless they have to, right? So Russia would fly on Russian, US would fly US. It's not as if they're going to do competitive bids with each other on a military satellite, right? So it's only when you're launching, commercial satellites that you can actually play the market, even, ITAR restrictions aside, which if anything would pull business to the United States, right? Even without ITAR, you've got a market. And it's very interesting to see how dramatically it's changed. You have, in light blue, China coming in, having a number of really dramatic failures early on in the 80s and 90s. Mostly in the early 90s with Loral and some other interesting stories that led to the formation of ITAR. And then, of course, the red, appropriately for Russia, coming on board. The far right bar, by the way, the most of it is, to be determined, right? It's for 2014 and 15, there's a lot of launch manifests, but until it actually plays out, we don't know exactly what the percentage bars will be. But it is SpaceX's belief that the United States, as you can see, is going to be making a comeback as they are. Now, this is, of course, very relevant because of all the businesses, presumably in the room, that would like to have lower cost launch. Now, this is the thing that, and this is the earliest version of the thing that will make a bigger difference still. This is the first Grasshopper test vehicle. All of you know about this. I'm sure you've seen the videos of their wonderful landings. But I like this one just because it's before the first flight in McGregor, Texas. There's a little guy working on it in there. And the legs clearly aren't as elegant as they are now. But what I also like is the quote. And I know I showed that quote last year, but it's especially appropriate right now because this is the 45th anniversary of Apollo. And it turns out Sir Arthur Clarke said those famous words on July 1969 as Apollo 11 was on its way to the moon. And his ability to see the importance of reusable boosters, which have never been done with liquid stage rockets, is really important. It's like, I mean, he even made the point, which seems sort of new and compelling today, that, wow, you know, why should it cost more than an airplane flight, right? So if you want to launch from a given point on Earth, fly around the entire Earth and land at that same point, why should that cost more than a flight in a comparable scaled plane? And in fact, SpaceX believes it shouldn't. And if they realize the dream of the reusable boosters, it won't be. This just to give you a sense of scale. On the left, the Falcon 9 version 1.1 with the legs folded up against the body, as many of you have seen. On the right, unless you visited their headquarters, you might not have seen what it looks like unpainted. It's beautiful carbon fiber layup. It's very wide on purpose. It acts as an air brake as you're coming down, and a huge helium-powered hydraulic arm that pushes the four legs down, and then they can control and feather as they come down. If we can switch, I'll actually just show a short one-minute video. I'm sure the real fans and enthusiasts have seen this, but I pulled it up, or I had them send it to me in HD of com flight just a week or so ago. And while we're, if it's an error, we can skip, if that just crashed the video player. Because we don't need to show it, I can just describe it. What do you think? Skip it? I mean, if your video player crashed that. Well, while they're getting it up, the thing that blows my mind, and it's hard, I always wish there was a time capsule where, you know, 20 years from now, let's say this works. And there's sound if you want to play it. 20 years ago, let's say this works, and it's sort of commonplace knowledge. What's really hard to recreate is the sense that prior to its success, everyone pretty much thought it would fail, right? The incumbents in the aerospace industry thought that a supersonic retro burn coming back to launch on the launch pad you came from and refuel and launch again in a matter of hours is just folly, right? And they would say things like, Elon, you just spend all your remaining dollars on that dream. Here you can see our ice crystals forming as it's coming back. And for the few perhaps who don't know what this is we're showing us, camera looking down the side of the booster where the majority of the cost of the rocket is, right? About 85% of the rocket's cost, 9 out of 10 engines. It launches up, second stage takes off, you know, does the rest of the primary mission. It turns around, burns 3 engines, comes back towards the launch pad, flips around again, uses those same engines to slow down. The legs come down as part of an air brake. It hovers over the ocean, in this case, just for testing, it lands on the ocean, because it's safer, which is not what you'd want to do, of course, and then falls over into the ocean. If that had been land, it would have been fine, both times, the last two flights. So what's really, and then we can flip back to the PowerPoint. What's really astounding to me is that it worked the first time, the very first time, and it worked again the second time. Now, in both cases, they lost the booster because of landing in the ocean, and in both cases, had it just been bold enough to try to land on land, it would have been fine, which is a testament to simulation tools being incredibly good these days. I mean, there are a lot of wind tunnels at NASA Ames for testing first, you know, normal flight and then a variety of esoteric flight conditions on Mars and such, testing parachutes is primarily what it's used for today. Those wind tunnels are increasingly less necessary, right, as our simulation sciences get better and better. And so this is quite a exciting time. You know, whether you're designing supersonic craft or cars and you want to know will you pass the crash test before you actually crash a car, all these things, of course, we take for granted now, are simulation sciences more than they are trial and error experimentations. Imagine if car design really was, I have no idea if I'll pass the crash test, and when I fail, I just go back to the drawing board and start over, right? Car design would take forever. There's, by analogy, the things one can do, the bold new things one can do in rocketry and in space. Benefit, of course, if you can iterate in the simulation domain. And there's simulators up the wazoo. They have this wonderful test rack called the Iron Maiden, just because it looks like a torture rig, where the entire flight electronics of the Falcon 9 are spread out. And they have a massive simulator rig that provides all the sensor inputs that one would experience on a flight to test all the possible scenarios, which is probably no surprise. This is what you do. But to be able to run millions and billions of experiments before you do your first try, that really helps, right? Now, why do reusability of the booster? This is actually a more subtle and interesting point that affects entrepreneurship in general. You know, it relates to the question of why is SpaceX succeeding, or why has Tesla succeeded so far in both cases to the extent they have versus incumbents who you would have assumed would be on top of these things, right? And I think the main reason in both those cases, as well as many others, is that when you start with a founding vision that is so far beyond what anyone else in the industry thinks is credible or believable, you oftentimes have to solve problems they just aren't worrying about. So, take Mars colonization, right? The founding vision of SpaceX. Not just going to Mars and planting a flag, but having a permanent base on Mars, sending millions of people to Mars. If that is your goal, there are all kinds of new thoughts you have that normal folks wouldn't have, like how do you reprocess what you can find on Mars into a fuel, like methane instead of kerosene? Things like landing under propulsive thrust, because that's a better way to get down on Mars or the moon if you were to land on the moon than parachutes, especially for the moon where there's no atmosphere, right? So images, of course, that's a cartoon on the top. That's not yet a real product of pre-release of the Mars colony. But that dream, right, motivates investments in things like the Draco thrusters and others, which, oh, by the way, and this is the key part that I haven't been able to figure out is, you know, every entrepreneur might think, oh, I've got a dream of, I don't know what, pick something bold. To actually translate back and chain back to the present, figure out what needs to be solved, and solve it in a way that creates a current business opportunity on the way. That's the challenge, right? We can all think about big, hairy things, like nuclear fusion, let's say, but if there's no business between here and there, that's a tough road to hoe, right, for a startup. What's astounding in SpaceX, Tesla, and other cases is when the entrepreneur can figure out, oh, if I solve this problem, not only does it let me reach my dream, it also revolutionizes business as it's done today. So, reusable boosters, right? It's a big investment, it's a big risk, right? If you're a current incumbent and your business is all about low Earth orbit and geostationary orbit insertions, why would you take the trouble unless you knew one of your competitors was doing it, right? It's much easier incrementally, year after year, to just make the 10% improvements on whatever it is you're doing and make money the way you've always made money instead of betting it all on something like this, right? Whereas SpaceX and other new entrants, that's what they do. Because otherwise, why would they ever have a chance if they don't do something very radically new and different? And this dream of Mars is interesting. On the bottom right corner is the entryway. The lobby is just to the right of the woman you see there. And so every employee walking into SpaceX for quite a while now has seen Mars on the left. It's huge. You can tell by scales. It's enormous. You know, that's the prize. That's why we come to work each day. The new one is I love it, is the terraformed version of Mars. It's sort of, as Elon says it, a bit of a fixer-upper planet. And and you can see that now motivates them. The Dragon, this was early on the left of the Dragon, man-rated capsule, as many of you probably saw, especially if you went to the opening. There's an interesting, slightly more modern version in terms of the image of what it might look like. And of course, part of the whole point of this is that, you know, unlike the 60s, where you had to dedicate your life to being an astronaut, bet on the timing working just right, and hope you get a launch before, let's say, a program gets canceled or your entire government goes under, like in the case of the Soviet Union. Here, the longer you wait, the safer and cheaper it should get, right? So for those of you who are dreaming of going to space one day, I think this is a really exciting and compelling vision, that it's not a limited time only, you know, grab your ticket while you can and only bizarre, you know, governments and weirdos and billionaires will have a chance to do this. It's, you know, something that could eventually trickle down, like air flight, to more and more of us as a dream. And it's certainly a dream I have as well. Now, of course, I have to show some hobby rockets just to placate my organizers. This was a wonderful one with a motor that's basically comes from a Canadian aerospace supplier, and it's used as a cruise missile booster, but in this case, on a decorative rocket that I put together with my son. And when we're playing out there in the desert, we strap on video cameras, we learn the limits of duct tape, and have a lot of fun as an engineering study. There's nothing like the visceral excitement of things blowing up to help make science tangible. It is rocket science, after all, and there's simulators and onboard computers to correlate what you thought was going to happen with what really did happen on altitude and speed and what have you. This carbon fiber one, we've taken past Mach 2 on 5 occasions. We kept pushing it further and further until it eventually shredded into what I think the military calls a rapid unscheduled disassembly, where literally every component was scattered across the playa down to the individual Duracell batteries were like separated from the boards. But it's all rebuilt and ready to fly again in September of this year. We're going to try to refly. And it was a point of pride to reuse every scrap component from there. It's just about a foot shorter now. I had to cut some of the carbon fiber off. Let's see, I'll just skip that. So, back to business. One time when I was out there, I think this was 2009, or was it 10? I'll have to go back and check. There were a couple of interesting science payloads that came from Stanford and NASA Ames. One was this astrobiology payload on the left that was going to try to sample the microbes that live up above where the balloons fly and where most rockets going into orbit don't stop, right, to hang out and take a sample, and store it in aerogel, bring it back and analyze spore formation, like what comes up from the Amazon basin in these huge convective currents and down elsewhere. But then there was also this bizarre cube you see on the bottom right corner that was a NASA Ames phone sat. This was the first I ever heard of such a thing at the time, so maybe that will date how far back it was. And they were blathering on about, you know, the phone, this HTC phone has more processing power and memory than any satellite in orbit, you know, the... It really was a symbolic conversation, I think, within NASA to say this could be a satellite. It works in a vacuum. You know, gosh, it's got a better camera than the Curiosity rover. You know, what? Why? Let's just throw one up in a CubeSat. And they have, as you know, Alexander Graham and Bell, the first three that went out. The bottom right, by the way, is a balloon test, not a rocket test, just in case you're curious what you're seeing there. But the upper two photos were the Rocket Mavericks, the launch vehicles that did do a wonderful stress test, the G-load test of this rocket, I mean of this phone. In fact, it came back ballistic and drove into the ground. And I love this. Just a few months ago, Maker Faire this year, the crystalline-looking thing, they've actually ensconced in Lucite, the phone from that desert activity, and it's completely shattered, right? Because, again, the phone drilled into the playa at incredible speed, but the data card was intact and the mission was more or less a success from a G-loading and testing perspective. And then some of the more modern phone sats from NASA there as well. Well, that led to a company. The people that were out there in the desert were the founders, it turns out, of Planet Labs. I kept in touch with them. We brainstormed while they continued to work at NASA Ames about opportunities in small sats. They eventually left. You're going to hear from Will Marshall tomorrow, the CEO. He's the fellow on the far right and was out there in the desert with his co-founder, Chris, there, both from NASA Ames. And what's interesting, some of you might know this, but when I first showed this image, and it was under embargo for quite a while, so I really always wanted to show it, is that unlike the other models I have in our office of SpaceX rockets or the Dragon capsule, this is not a model. This is the first satellite. That's what's not. It's what's one-to-one scale because it's the real thing. And you can see how radically different that is from traditional Greyhound bus-sized satellites. And I think the Planet Labs vision is quite simply described, by anyone who has any experience in photography, that the cost of and weight of a lens goes exponentially high, whether it's a telescope or a simple SLR lens from Nikon or Canon, right? If you have an 800-millimeter zoom that's f2 something, it's going to be a beast. In fact, that thing's almost unaffordable. Whereas the equivalent lens, if you just get closer to your subject, is much smaller, lighter, and ineffective. And so commercial off-the-shelf telescopes, commercial off-the-shelf everything is what makes these satellites four orders of magnitude less expensive than anything else that came before them. In fact, just about everything I've seen in the space industry is at least two orders of magnitude cheaper than the incumbents, just as a general observation. It's like, I don't know any other industry where there's a bigger inefficiency gap to be meted out. This is why Elon got into rockets when he spoke to the Russians and realized the cost of goods of the metal they bend into a rocket is 3% of the price they're charging. No other industry is like that, right? But for patents, which don't exist in that case, and like, why? I mean, you could lower cost 10x and still have good gross margins, which is exactly what he's doing. Now, Planet Labs, as some of you know, have gone out and launched a bunch of these satellites. This is their latest ground station in the upper left. On the right is at Stanford Dish, where I was there with them in the trailer as they pulled down their very first image over Washington, where compared to Google Earth, there's a lot of deforestation that had occurred just in the ensuing period. They then, of course, have lost a flock of doves, 28 at a time, up out of station. The first flock, and by the way, the good thing about launching out of the station is you can get these incredible images, which normally you never see, of your own satellites being deployed. The sense of scale difference also is pretty striking when you look at those solar arrays compared to the two of those little satellites popping up. And the very first light, they opened their eyes, and the first one, it just happened to be straight over UC Davis, which is kind of amazing. It's where my wife went to med school, and I recognize almost all of that, which is just kind of coincidence. They've launched another 28 that are currently at station about to deploy. And when you summarize it, it's pretty amazing. Try to compare this to any other satellite company you know of. In the last 15 months, they've had six separate launch vehicles, right? Six separate launches. They have 71 satellites in orbit, right? And by the end of this year, it'll be a much larger number. But most interestingly, they've built a new satellite design every 6 weeks, continuously over 15 months, right? That is what they call agile aerospace. That is very different from probably any other satellite company you've heard of, including the new entrants, right? No one that I know of has deployed that many satellites and taken images like this. These two are a couple of the newest ones. Top one from Brazil. The bottom one, interestingly, is just from yesterday. And it's a photo of a fire that broke out in California, and they took the photo 15 minutes after it was first reported in the news. The point of Planet Labs, by the way, is not just lower cost, you know, two orders of magnitude. It's to cover the entire Earth every day. And that capability should be online here soon and offers capabilities that are quite remarkable, both for existing markets as well as new markets that haven't existed before. So when there's deforestation in the Amazon, catch them while it's happening. Or illegal fishing, catch it while it's happening. Or responding to a disaster zone. Every other Earth observation satellite is a point and shoot model. You have to know ahead of time what you're going to prioritize, like I need eyes on Afghanistan or whatever you hear in the movies. Whereas this is a raster scan of the planet, right? And so by definition, if a tornado or an earthquake or a nuclear disaster or whatever it might be happens, you do have the before and after imagery, which is very different for first responders and just about everything in the NGO world, for conflict zones and what have you, because sometimes you don't know an area is interesting until after you've passed over. There's no cost, that's sort of the temporal aspect. There's also the coverage. Imagine you want to look at global crop health and futures, to know how every cornfield in the world is doing, every wheat field in the world, every day. That's an unprecedented amount of information. And others have already started to show that you could do, you know, interesting stunts for hedge fund managers, like count every car in every Walmart parking lot every day, you know, just to make some money. But that's obviously the least inspired application. So let me perhaps end with this image and a provocative question. We're going to be doing a seminar, actually, these sort of ties to Planet Labs. They're organizing and presenting a thought of how we could radically lower people's thoughts about how expensive it would be to have a permanent moon base. Like imagine, again, 100x less, because everything in aerospace is in space is 100x less if you actually look at it at fresh eyes. And we're going to bring people, you know, synthetic biologists like George Church and, of course, folks from all different branches of NASA and elsewhere to try to really see if we could rethink this whole thing. Why does it have to be so expensive? Maybe I'll end with a note of humor, and that part of the bait to get people to come there, there's a couple of the newest artifacts that I've acquired. There was a reference to that. So in the upper right corner is actually the largest slice of the largest known rock on the moon, on the Earth, from the moon. Right? There's probably plenty of lunar material at the bottom of the ocean that we'll just never know. But of the ones that have been provably from the lunar highlands, that is the largest slice. It's gorgeous. It's pretty big. And you touch the moon, which sort of, I love it. I mean, in the office, I'll be like, my, the moon looks beautiful today, because it's right there on the left. And then the bottom right's actually quite a remarkable artifact, too. It's a huge chunk, the EVA handle, the external EVA handle from Columbia, the Apollo 11 command module. And the only reason it exists, because all the others have been destroyed, is because those little glow-in-the-dark tabs, there's four of them, two on each side, that contain promethium-147 and were considered radiological waste. And so all of the handles from the Apollo were destroyed, because the fear was they might crack in the Smithsonian, leak out. If someone ingests it, it could be a problem. But it's not. It's got a 2.5 year half-life. It's inert, and no one's eating, you know, licking the capsule, right? So that's not really a legitimate concern. It is funny, though. I went back and looked. Apollo 10 was delayed because one of those things cracked. So there was at least some history to say this freaks people out, perhaps unnecessarily. So the reason it exists and wasn't destroyed is a veterinarian doctor who knew a bit about radiological elements in the body for imaging and such said, look, this is silly. Give me one of these handles. I'll study it for 20 years, and my only payment will be I get to keep the handle when I'm done. And they did, and they did a contract with Chris Kraft. That's why it's the only one saved. Everything in the Smithsonian is a replacement dummy. It's not the actual flown hardware. So I'll end with that. I'm not going to actually show, oh, maybe I will. I will show this one thing, because I do have a couple minutes. Why now, right? We always look for disruptions, something that's changing the landscape. So why is now an interesting time for new space? Maybe this is a good place to end it. Things like SpaceX lowering cost of access, I made that point. If you can reuse the booster, it should lower cost another 10x still. Simulation, I've alluded to that a couple times. It's great when you don't have to iterate, whether it's your satellite design or your launch vehicle, on things like that. Commodity hardware. We like to say, and I think I first heard this from Chris Anderson at 3D Robotics, that many of these businesses benefit from the peace dividend of the cell phone wars. You know, harkening back to the phone set, it's not literally the phone, it's the discombobulated parts of it, right? The six-axis accelerometers, low-power electronics, the battery technology, and what have you, that make it possible to build things like these new drones, robots, and satellites so very inexpensively. And many of the businesses realize that they can dematerialize the thing and focus on the software. So whether it's a new robot, whether, frankly, it's, if you look under the covers why Tesla thinks they do things uniquely from every other car company, it's because of the software layer. Same for the way SpaceX does it, right? When they first launched at Cape Canaveral, there was about a 2 to 3 month delay on their very first Falcon 9 launch because of software validation protocols NASA had to go through. They'd never seen object-oriented software before on any launch vehicle. This concept that you'd have 30,000 changes in your software prior to a launch, and each one of them, by old methods, had to go through a review process, that just kind of broke the process. My point is just software is increasingly the point of differentiation in all these markets, these hardware markets that I mentioned. That's why we're investing in it, by the way, and why we didn't 15 years ago. Because if it's a hardware business, meaning if it's bent iron, like if the only basis of competition is volume and scale and can you source supplies of aluminum more cheaply than other sources of aluminum, that's not a good place for any new entrant, right? Because the winners will be the ones with the most capital, the most market presence, and the big get bigger and the small get crushed. The only time new entrants have a chance is if there's disruption and when it's a change of the playing field, especially if it's moving from something that isn't software to software. That's great, because people who don't understand software, businesses, individuals, business units, they really have a hard time shifting, in every industry that I've seen. Of course, it's always great when you have access to global markets. That's true. Think about Planet Labs, right? Prior to the internet, all that imagery would be a tough sell. You'd have to have people walking around the planet trying to do direct sales models, right? Now you could make it all open source. Let developers, app developers, deal with this enormous tsunami of big data, right, that's gonna be coming from these imaging satellites to do, of course, all the algorithms to count the cars or measure the crop health. You know, Planet doesn't have to do all that. They can provide the data. That's sort of an obvious point in this internet era, but sort of underscores the reason why a business model like that makes sense now, and it wouldn't if you were starting a Earth observation company 20 years ago, pre-internet, right? You wouldn't be able to think those ways. And of course, Agile Aerospace, by the way, maybe I'll end with this point. It allows you to iterate in a very interesting way. Not just can you use the latest and greatest and iterate more quickly, but if you think about it, if you just force yourself to launch, let's say you're gonna just launch a new version every year, just taking advantage of Moore's Law, the doubling of compute power per dollar spent, or the doubling of storage density per dollar spent with each year, gives you an incredible advantage for someone who, let's say, I think is a 10-year design cycle. So take one of the greatest recent technical accomplishments, which is an amazing accomplishment, the Curiosity rover, right? It's driving around the Mars, it's this incredible thing, right? It has a 2-megapixel camera. Not because it's an old thing, it's because the design freeze was 10 years ago. When you look at the entire pipeline of what gets you, Mars, of course, is a special case given the launch windows, you can't just use this year's version of the camera and then, oh, change the processor and the memory and everything else in your data bus. The traditional model, in just for time scales, if you're gonna say, oh, I need a vetting process of this long, I need to have this, you know, only use components that are space proven, you end up using a technology suite and process that puts you behind, because 10 years of Moore's Law is 1,000-fold, right? 2 to the 10th power is 1024. So just waiting 10 years gives a new entrant who doesn't wait and just goes with the latest and greatest, a 1,000-fold advantage even if they do nothing smart, right? Even if they don't take advantage of anything else that's improved in the last 10 years. That's kind of a dramatic way to draw the point that sometimes just launching whatever, seeing if it works, then launching another one is a better way to go than getting it right the first time. So, you know, failure has to be an option. Failure, if it's not happening, is a problem, right? It's sort of, we need to recast that mentality that comes, of course, from our Apollo era. So why don't I end it at that, because I think I've gone over, right? And say thank you very much.